Boom whackers. Well, church, good morning. I want to welcome you this morning to worship here at St. Paul's, our first Sunday, back in our program year with our two services. I want to just welcome you here in person, those of us who are worshiping online with us today. It's a good day to be in God's house. Before we begin our announcements this morning, I just want to, I think for most of you, reintroduce and maybe for of you introduce for the first time, someone who's going to be here with us over the course of the coming year. We're going to have an opportunity later in the month in our service to lay hands on him, to pray for him, and to ask God for his blessing on his ministry here. David Geller. David, would you stand this morning? Many of you met David earlier in the summer. David will be doing his pastoral internship. That's a requirement for Master of Divinity programs, to do a year-long internship in a local church and get experience in all the different facets of ministry. So David will be doing that here with us at St. Paul's. And as I said, we're going to have an opportunity to kind of really warmly welcome him a little later in the month in our service. But I just wanted to reintroduce or perhaps introduce some of you for the first time to David. And I know you're going to be blessed as you get to know him over the course of the year. I'm going to invite Melissa, our Director of Youth and Families, to come to share announcements this morning. Melissa?
Good morning. Many, many announcements in your bulletins. Take a look here. We have fall fundraisers with Mums. We have lots of activities, new Bible studies starting up, lots of great things just for your information. We have more information also on our website as well as our Facebook and Instagram pages. That's one thing. If you want information from us, like our News in the Pews, which is our weekly online newsletter, kind of like a weekly circuit rider in a way. We update it weekly. If you go on our website and you update your email preferences at the top, it says it there. You can get the News in the Pews each week. It comes out on Thursday nights at 8 o'clock, so you'll always have the updated information. If you have a problem with it or a problem signing up, you can see me. I run that page, so I'd be happy to help you set that up. We have lots more information to come to you, but right now I'm going to call up Mr. Rick Young. He has a special Bible study he wants to start, and he is going to give you some special information about that.
Morning, everyone. You see in the bulletin, we're going to do a study entitled Understanding the Kingdom. Most Christians have a good working knowledge of what the kingdom of heaven is like and what it is. This will be an in-depth study. Why do an in-depth study? We look to Jesus as our example. Jesus, when he first begins his ministry after being tempted by Satan three times, successfully overcoming them, begins his ministry, and one would think the very first thing that Jesus would talk about is, believe in me to have eternal life. But the very first recorded message, Jesus says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Very first thing. A few verses later, we're told that Jesus went throughout Galilee preaching in the synagogues the gospel of the kingdom. And a few verses later, we're now in chapter 5 of Matthew, in the Sermon on the Mount, the very first beatitude is, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We don't hear Jesus talk about believing in him for eternal life until we actually get to John chapter 3 when he talks with Nicodemus. And there, the first thing he talks about with Nicodemus is the kingdom of heaven, twice. If this issue is that important with Jesus, it may be worthwhile to have a more in-depth understanding of it. And for those who are alive, in the time frame immediately preceding Christ's return, Jesus makes known in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 24 that it's not just important to understand the issues of the kingdom, it will be critical for that generation. So we're going to look at all of this. It's October 12th. It's a Saturday. It begins at 8 a.m. Ouch, I know. We will need all 4 hours. When I've done it in the past, between comments and questions, it usually lasts about that long. Sign-up sheet in the narthex, so I know how many copies of the handout to run off. All you need to do is bring your Bible and a pen or pencil, and I look forward to seeing those who are led to the study. Thank you very much.
We have just a few more things. Ooh, hold on. I should know better. We have just a few more announcements for you. One is, in your pews, there are also Connect cards. If you want information or need information from us, or need to give us new information, those cards will be collected during time of offertory, as well as our prayer requests, which get put into the bulletin for the following week. And also, we address them out on our Facebook during our prayer and check-in time on Wednesdays around noon. So that's another thing. Two special, we have lots of things to sign up for. We're at the beginning of our year, so there's lots going on, lots and lots and lots. In this narthex, you have the sign up for the women's of St. Paul's doing the church picnic on September 22nd. They want to know like what dish you're going to bring. They're going to provide hamburgers and hot dogs by the men who will provide those, and they'll provide the drinks, but they need to know what you're going to bring so we don't get 1,800 potato salads. We could do that, and then we could judge the potato salads, but I think people would prefer if we had a variety of foods. So if you can put down what you'd like to bring, that would be great. Another thing to eat, because Methodists, we love to eat. We have fellowship dinner coming up. When you go down to fellowship time, down in Norcross Hall this way, you could sign up for the fellowship dinner. That way they know how many people are coming. So many items. Two things to note, there will not be regular midweek worship this week. We will be gathering at Windward Park because it is on the anniversary of September 11th. There's a September 11th memorial service that goes every year. There are people in this church that were directly affected. So we like to go and give our support there. Pastor Evan will go and be a part of that service with the rest of the Brick Ministerium. So if you'd like to join us, that will be on Wednesday at 6 p.m. at Windward Beach. We have put those announcements as well on our pages. So you can look to there. Now we have one final announcement, and that is going to come from our director of music, Amanda Roars.
Good morning, church. It's so good to be together as we kick off the program year. Happy, happy back to school Sunday? Yeah, we could call it that. If you don't know me, my name is Amanda Roars, and I am the Director of Music Ministries here at St. Paul's. And just as all of our Sunday school classes and Bible studies are starting up, so are all of our choirs. The chancel choir has already begun. That's our grown-up choir, and they'll be singing for you this morning. But I just wanted to give you an update on our children's choirs. The carol choir, which is led by Mrs. Propert, grades 2nd through 5th, will begin this Thursday at 6:30. And then the celebration choir, led by Miss Judy Tomes, which is for our middle and high school youth, will begin the following Thursday at 6:30. We've shifted our start time a little bit. Mrs. Post's choir, the Cherub Choir, which is for our 4-year-old through first graders, will meet on the 18th, not this Wednesday, the following Wednesday, at their usual time of 4:30. And we are going to try something a little new this year for our members of the Carol and Celebration Choir. And that is, if they would like to come half an hour early at 6 o'clock, we are going to have a little percussion boom whacker choir. Now, what is a boom whacker other than a really fun word, right? It's super fun to say. Well, Beatrice and I are going to show you really quick, okay? Let me get them. Hold your breath. These are boom whackers. Think about like the baby step towards handbells, okay? So instead of ringing bells, we have plastic that is safe. No, you can't hurt it and it can't hurt you. And it's color-coded, so you don't need to read music. Isn't that beautiful? And this, right? A great way to teach them. And so each color is a different note, and you just make a sound by going like this. Can you hear that? So we... And then Beatrice had to do pink. So if you would just like to come and have some fun with the Boomwhackers and you are the carol or celebration choir age, come join us next Thursday once everyone is all started at 6 o'clock for some fun with the Boomwhackers. I do have one other very exciting announcement to make from the music department. Hold on, let me put these down. Thank you. That's beautiful tone. That's a beautiful tone. As you may remember from over last year, our beloved organ is on her last legs. She's 51 years old, and they just don't make technology to last that long. Well, thanks to an anonymous donor, we currently have a new organ being built right now in the factory. And it should arrive before Thanksgiving. So it's very, very exciting. We're just gonna enjoy her for these next few weeks, and then we get to welcome in a brand new instrument. So God is so very, very good. So thank you.
All right, well, at this time we're gonna go into our service. A couple things to let you know. There's lots going on here, lots of new Bible studies. Thursday, there are 3 new Bible studies starting up. So if you're interested, there's room. We have Bill Beaver leading one on a Max Lucado study on Thursday nights, I believe it's starting at 7. And then I have one starting at 6, which will be based on the sermons that Pastor Evan is doing for James. We'll call it Sermon Notes. And I will have those available, and that will be at 6 o'clock. And then Bill Propert also has his study at the same time as the Carol Choir beginning as well. So lots and lots of Bible studies, and more than that as well. Please look at our Facebook, look at our website, and please pay attention. If News in the Pews, we put all that stuff in there. So we just want to make sure you see all that we have here at St. Paul's. It's great that we have an abundance. Let's take this time to have an abundance of time to focus our hearts, to think about worship and to focus our minds on worship with our prelude. Will you please join me with an opening word of prayer? Dear Lord, we thank you so much for this time you have given us, time to worship and time to gather in your name. Lord, we thank you for our time to be able to lift up in song, to hear your word in from our word, and be able to apply messages to our lives. Lord, just thank you and open our hearts to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's take our first hymn of praise. It's going to be Immortal, Invisible God, Only Wise. You may find this in United Methodist Hymnals. That's the red hymnal on page 103. Again, 103. The words will also be behind me on the screen behind me. Please stand as you are able.
Just the church program year, but also the school year, and we're going to offer just a blessing for our kids who are going back to school, whether they're in a preschool or whether they're finishing up a college. We want to give God thanks and ask for God's blessing. So I'm going to invite Courtney Zaplinski, our director of the Mustard Seed program here, to lead us in that this morning, and then I believe you all be invited to participate in that. Courtney.
Good morning. Actually, is it okay? Can I bring the kids up for this?
Oh, yeah, huh?
I'm going to, yep, all of the students, college to preschool, if you want to make your way up, come on up. If you brought your backpack or a lunchbox to be blessed, come sit right here in the middle.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, great. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. It's nice to see you all again. Welcome, welcome. Oh, perfect. Yeah, we can bless just about anything. Anything, your sneakers count as a blessing. All right, I'm gonna make my way to the front. Your boot counts. If it's coming with you to school, it counts. All right, who's excited for another school year? Who's kind of about another school year? And who wishes it was still summer? Yeah, me too. I love summer. Well, my friends, today I wanted to offer a special prayer over school, a special prayer over the parents, the teachers, and staff, and everybody who makes school and education happen. And education happens in a lot of different ways, right? I'm the director of the preschool. Our education happens through play. We play all day, and that's how we learn. Right, Charlie? Right? Yeah, yes. And then we get older, and we go into kindergarten and elementary school, and we still have lots of elements of play, but we start to learn in a classroom. Then we go into middle school. It's a free-for-all, right? Yeah, you just survive it. And then in high school, you get to actually choose some of your classes. You get to choose some of your courses. And then you get to go to college. And college is awesome because it's all about who you want to be when you grow up. So we're going to pray over all of those things. Are you ready to join me in prayer? Let's bow our heads and pray. Dear God, watch over all the children. Keep them safe. Help them to make good friends and to be a good friend. Lord God, be with all of the parents this school year. Give them comfort as they send their children off to school, and give them strength if they choose to homeschool. Lord God, we pray for all of the staff, everybody's teacher, your paraprofessionals, your bus drivers, your playground aides, and your administrative staff. Lord, give them all focus on the students, patience to get through, and support for a good school year. Lord God, we pray for your safety among the children present here and all over. Lord, give them your guidance and your wisdom on how to be a good friend, and let them have a fun and knowledgeable year. In your name we pray, amen. Stay there, stay there. Don't move, don't move. Turn around and face me, because I'm not coming down there yet. Why? Because my lesson deals with being up here. So we're going to do it. Are you ready? Hello, everybody. Wow, big crowd. We love the big crowd. Okay, and it applies to everybody. So we're at the beginning of the school year, and that's something fun for us to know, but there's always something we need to remember. When we go into school, what we're trying to do is put on our listening ears, and we're trying to have a mouth where we speak kindness and goodness. But that did not come when you started school, or when I started school, or even when your grandparents started school. This message of kindness comes all the way from our lesson today in James. And in James, there's a scripture that says that everyone should be quick to listen, should be slow to speak, and should be slow to anger. So we want to listen. We want to make sure that before we say something, we think about it, that we also... if we're angry, we need to think about why we're getting angry and have a thought about it. It says in the scripture that if a man is just kind of, you know, not listening to the word of God and not working on it, that he is like a man who looks in his reflection, this mirror here. Look at you. Can I see you in the mirror? Oh, there you are. There's you. But it's like he sees himself in the mirror and oh, he doesn't even know what he looks like. That's what scripture says if we're not in the word. But here's the thing with this. What does a mirror do? It does something specific. Okay, what does it do? You tell me.
It makes things look different.
Oh, it could make things look a little different. It could be this one actually could make you big or small because it has a small side and a big side, right? Mirrors do something else. It starts with an R. Oh, there it is.
Reflection.
Reflection. It reflects. If we're reflecting the word of God, and we're actually reflecting what God wants us to do, and we're careful with our words, careful with our emotions, well, that's something to reflect. So, like, here's the thing. If I'm only reflecting myself in this small mirror, can you see yourselves in this mirror right now? No, of course you can't. It's a tiny mirror, because I'm only focused on myself. But in the church, we focus on a lot of not just ourselves, but each other. Of course, my mirror is going to be broken, but that's not the point. I got it. All right. But if I have this mirror is a little bigger, right? And if I do this, do some of you see each other? Do you see yourselves? Oh, for the love. I see you. I see each and every one of you in the reflection. If I point it this way, You see yourselves, right? Oh, no. Okay, well, anyway, the literalness of this is we can reflect with each other. We can mirror each other's good behavior, but also the behavior God has taught us in the Word. The more people see that, the more they want to do that. The more they want to do that, the better we can be. The better we can be, the more people we reflect out what Christ wants us to be. So we can reflect Christ's love if each of us is listening, slow to what we need to say and we think about it, and slow to anger. That's a big lesson. That's a lesson from the time you're this big to the time you're all the way grown. All right? So let's pray together. Are you ready? I want you to repeat after me. Big group. We should be able to hear everybody. Let's pray together. Dear God, help us to reflect you and your word. Amen. All right, you guys, you can go to Sunday school.
And let's stand this morning and greet one another.
It's now prayer time. Let's join our hearts together as we go before the Lord. Most loving and gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you so very, very much for creating us, for sending your Son down here. And we pray to you this morning through Jesus. And we thank you so very much for your word, where it tells us, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. A little further down it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory. Thank you so very much for God's Word, that we may study, that we may meditate, and we may take into the depths of our soul, so that living water would flow through us to other people. And we thank you for Jesus' glory from the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. We pray, Lord, this morning that we would listen to God's word and receive the truth as Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And we also thank you, Father, for grace from the cross, how Jesus gave us forgiveness and how he bought our salvation for each and every one of us. We pray, Father, that this would grow and live within us. At this time of our prayer, I pray that each and every one would pray this short prayer within your heart. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my Redeemer. Let's take this time for each and every one of you to go before the throne of grace personally. We continue in prayer, thanking you, Father, for all the hospitals, all the rehabs and nursing homes that we have to serve people. We thank you, Father, and pray a special blessing upon all the nurses, doctors, and aides. And we pray, Father, for those who are in these institutions, that they would be healed and be restored back to their ministry. We thank you, Father, for this tremendous service that we have. We turn this prayer now to the world situation, and we pray for all those countries with rumors and wars that are going on. We pray especially for your promised land to Abraham, and we thank you, Lord, for all the countries that are supporting that. We pray your will would be done. And we also pray for our own country, for all the violence, and for all the unrest, and all the unhappiness that we have right now. We pray sincerely, Father, for revival. And we also pray that that revival would change us, and that the power of the Holy Spirit would flow through each and every one of us to someone today. We now close this prayer, Father, with the prayer that your Son gave us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Thank you, Bill.
We invite our ushers to come forward this morning to receive our offering, and for our choir to come. The first choir anthem of the year. So the choir will come and bless us with music as our offering is taken. I want to thank you again for your generosity to our church in supporting its mission and ministries and all that we're able to do. It's because of you and your generosity.
Praises ring in the sanctuary, sing,
to the Lord. Open up your heart. Make a joyful noise in the sanctuary. Sing, sing it to the Lord. Lavish Him with love. Let the praises ring in the sanctuary. Sing! Give Him praise, open up your heart to give Him praise. Lift up holy hands, unashamed, in the sanctuary. God, open up your mouth and give Him praise. Open up your heart and give Him praise. Lift up holy hands, unashamed, sing, sing, sing. God, open up your mouth and give Him praise. Open up your heart and give Him praise. Lift up holy hands, unashamed, in the sanctuary. God, open up your mouth and give Him praise. Open up your heart and give Him praise. To the holy hands, unashamed, sing, sing, sing. God, open up your mouth and give Him praise. Open up your heart and give Him praise. To the holy hands, unashamed, in the sanctuary. God, open up your mouth and give Him praise. Open up your heart and give Him praise. To the holy hands, unashamed, sing, sing, sing. God, open up your mouth and give Him praise. Open up your heart.
As you're able, I invite you to rise as we sing the doxology. Almighty God, receive these gifts that have been given today by faith, that you can use them, turn them into vehicles for bringing the good news of Christ to those around us. We pray in His name. Amen. Please remain standing for our hymn. You'll find it on the screen and in your hymnal on page 140.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. Please be seated.
Good morning, St. Paul's. Our first Old Testament reading is Psalm 15, which can be found on page 853 in your pew Bible. Lord, who may dwell in your sacred tent? Who may live on your holy mountain? The one whose walk is blameless, who does what is righteous, who speaks the truth from their heart, whose tongue utters no slander, who does no wrong to a neighbor, and casts no slur on others, who despises a vile person, but honors those who fear the Lord, who keeps an oath even when it hurts and does not change their mind, who lends money to the poor without interest, who does not accept a bribe against the innocent. Whoever does these things will never be shaken. The second reading is from James 1, 17, verse 17 through 27, which can be found on page 1881 in your pew Bible. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. This is the word of God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, friends, would you pray with me this morning? Loving and holy God, as we come to your word, as we open it, as we seek to hear from you, Lord, move us out of the way of our own lives, our own agendas for ourselves, our own wills, and allow us to hear clearly from you what you would say, what you would have for us. May we become more like Christ in all that we say and all that we do. We pray in his name. Amen. I want to tell you about an embarrassing experience I had once. Perhaps for a young man, one of the most embarrassing experiences that I could have had. I was 18 years old. I was in college, and I had just joined the local United Methodist Church. Y'all know I come from a Baptist background. There's still people in my family who don't know what to do with me as a sole Methodist in a pretty extended family. So here I was. It was after church, and I was out to lunch with a couple from this church with whom I had become quite close. And I was sitting there having lunch. We were talking. We were laughing. We were having a good time. And I heard a voice come all the way across this crowded dining room. People who were there for lunch after worship in their respective churches. And this is what the voice said. You must be Billy's son. Billy's my dad. If I could have gotten under that table, curled up in a ball and hidden, I would have done that. But I was far too big to get under that little booth. When you're 18 years old, Let me tell you, if you're not there yet, or if you've been there, perhaps you can resonate. One of the kind of the last things you want to do is have someone call out in a crowded room that you look just like your parents. Oh, my goodness. It was a woman who knew my family and hadn't seen me in a long, long time. But there's oftentimes, and I have no problem admitting it now, if I stand next to my dad, you can see the resemblance. All of us, whether we like it or not, at age 18 or at the age you're at now, you carry something of your family of origin with you everywhere you go. Maybe it's your physical looks. Maybe it's the way that you say certain phrases. Maybe it's a lilt in your voice. Maybe it's your gait, the way that you walk. Maybe it's the things that you enjoy doing. All of us are shaped and marked by our parents, and we are a reflection of that out into the world. Sometimes to such a degree that a stranger could see me in a restaurant and knew right away who my father was. Think of that metaphor that we are reflections of our families and the world for just a moment. And I want you to carry that with you over the next few weeks as you look at the book of James. Because the intent of the writer of the book of James is that you and I, more and more every day, in all that we say and all that we do, would be a reflection of Christ out into the world. The book of James is concerned with this. If you have had a transforming encounter with the grace of God made known in Jesus Christ, applied by the Holy Spirit into our lives, then that should necessarily change us and shape us into particular people as we live out our lives in the world. In other words, on the ground, what does our faith look like? That's what the writer of the book of James seeks to impart to us. The writer of the book of James, most scholars believe it's James, who is the brother of Jesus. There's a few different James mentioned in the New Testament, but throughout the church history, the majority of people have ascribed the authorship of this book to James, the brother of Jesus. And in fact, if you compare the prose and style in the book of James with this long speech that James gives in Acts chapter 15, you find similarities in syntax and style and construction. And James is writing to this first generation of the church, this young group of Christians who are seeking just this. Now they're following Jesus. Now what? What does that look like when human division and disagreement arises? Well, how does it look like in a church when there are rich people and there are poor people and people all the way in between? What's the church supposed to do with socioeconomic disparities? What is the church supposed to do when people start speaking in unkind, unchristian ways to and about other people? What is the church supposed to do when some people among it get sick? What is the role of prayer in the life of the church? All of these ways that faith is practically lived out in the world is the concern of the author of James. James, as I shared with the folks who were at our midweek service this past week, James is 5 chapters. And as such, we can understand his construction this way. He takes chapter 1. And he sets out his thesis. Any of you remember from school a 5-paragraph essay? Well, in my undergrad school, I worked in the writing center. And it was really my job to help these incoming English 101 students to construct a 5-paragraph essay. So let's refresh ourselves together as to exactly what that is. Miss Courtney knows. Awesome. A 5-paragraph essay is you start in your first paragraph and you develop what's called your thesis statement. In other words, you lay forth to your audience what it is that you intend to prove or to show in the entirety of your essay. And so you lay it out. And James does that in the first chapter. We're going to see that in just a moment. And then, in a 5-paragraph essay, and really in the book of James, he takes chapters 2, 3, and 4 to give supporting evidence to his thesis. And then toward the latter part of chapter 5, he takes the final paragraph, as it were, or the final chapter in our case. He reinforces his thesis, summarizes, wraps up, and closes his work. And so here in chapter 1, we really see everything that James is going to expound upon over the next several chapters, next 3 chapters, really. Go back with me. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to invite you to turn there back to chapter 1. We're going to look at something here that James lays out for the people. And that is, for the person who's encountered Jesus Christ, for the person seeking to live out their faith, what is the role of God's Word? How does that form us as people? We're going to see in the book of James that James is concerned with this, that the Word of God should humble people, that it should shape people, and that it should liberate them, set them free. So here in the book of James, we see in verse 19, everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. We find the first key to the sort of Christian life that James is seeking to instruct these early believers in, and that is a life of humility. What's humility? How might we define humility? Sometimes we find these words in the Bible, and we just assume we know what they mean, but then we have to sit and think about them and give them definition. It gives us a little pause. What is humility? Kind of one of those things, sometimes you know it when you see it, but it's hard to define it, right? Humility. The opposite of arrogance, and arrogance is, you know, being self-centered, being prideful. What does humility require of an individual? Empathy? Self-reflection? There's a particular word that comes to my mind when I think of humility, and that is submission. You put yourself under the authority of someone or something else. So often it seems in our culture, and indeed, friends, if we're honest with ourselves, even in our churches, the impulse can be that our relationship with Scripture is this: here we are, and here's the Bible. After all, we're 21st century Western individuals with the benefit of science and technology. We can come to Scripture and, well, you know, this thing makes sense, but oh, here are some other things in Scripture, and we're so advanced, we don't need those sorts of things. The tendency can be to put ourselves above Scripture, when it should be this way. Rather than us paging through the books of Scripture and finding out what we like and what we don't like, it should be Scripture paging through the book of our life and instructing us in change and transformation. That impulse to put ourselves above, or to be the arbiters of what God has clearly said, goes all the way back to the very beginning in the book of Genesis, doesn't it? What is the thing that the tempter says to Eve in the Garden of Eden in chapter 3? Eve, did God really say that? To get human beings, Eve, all the way down through the ages, to you and me sitting here in these pews, to doubt and to then put ourselves above what God has said. James says, no, we need to humbly receive and accept what God has said. The Scripture should humble us, particularly when we come to parts that don't make sense. Hear me this morning. I am not then saying that everything in Scripture makes sense and we just take it blindly. God gave us faculties of reason, common sense. It's called interpretation. It's called, to use a fancy, churchy, theological word, it's called hermeneutics. You bring certain methods of interpretation to Scripture, but at the end of the day, with an attitude of humility, we understand that maybe there are things that we don't understand. But God's wisdom and God's ways are higher than ours. And sometimes things are given to us on a need-to-know basis. Maybe there's something unclear to you today in Scripture that a year from now will make total sense. And maybe there's something today that you think makes total sense, and in a year from now you will be wrestling with it. That is fine. That is part of the life of faith. But our fundamental attitude toward Scripture is that it reads us. It is above us. We submit to it. That's humility. Secondly, Scripture shapes us. And how do we know that it shapes us? Well, look at what the author of the book of James says. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. I discovered something fascinating that I had not connected before here in these verses. Do you hear it? It contrasts two ways of encountering Scripture as Scripture shapes us. One is someone who comes to a mirror, and actually the implication in the Greek is someone glances at themselves in the mirror. What is a glance but a quick passing by look? You don't take a whole lot in. You don't get to see the full picture. Perhaps a glance, you might even get an absolutely incorrect image of what it is that's in front of you. James says there's those folks who come to Scripture, come to the word that God has given them, and they glance at it, and then they go away. But because they've just glanced at it, it can't transform them and change them. And so they really become ones who just hear it, but they have not looked at it long enough to be able to then do it. But then he says there's someone who comes and looks intently. There's another passage of Scripture where the same word is used, looking intently. And that's when Peter comes to the empty tomb on Easter morning. And he and the other disciple in the Gospel of John run to the tomb. And Peter, rather than kind of standing around on the outside like the other disciple with trepidation, runs right into the tomb. And do you know what it says in the Greek? He looks intently. Was that just a glance? Did he come in and just have a quick look around and then leave? No. All of his faculties are firing. He's taking in all of the evidence. He's trying to make sense of something that is just beyond the boundaries of normal course of human events. He's studying it. He's trying to make sense of it. In the same way, James says, that's how you and I should be with Scripture. Looking at it intently, wrestling with it, trying to make sense of it, looking at connections. Only then, does James say, that you can be transformed and moved from someone who just listens to then someone who actually does. Have to immerse ourselves in Scripture. So how do we know that we're humbled by Scripture, that it's shaping us, and that it's finally setting us free to do what God desires? Let's define freedom for just a moment. What is freedom? Being able to choose. Okay. A freedom of speech and expression. I will say to you that the way the Bible defines freedom and the way we often think about freedom are completely opposed to one another. We're built here in America on the freedom of the individual. The freedom to be free from constrictions and boundaries and to just be able to be who we are, to be ourselves. At least that seems to be the cultural mantra around us, doesn't it? The biblical view of freedom is concerned with something so different. That you and I have been set free not to do what we want to do, but to do what is right, what God wants us to do, what you and I were created to do, which often goes against the impulses of the human heart. Think of this. Over and over through the Hebrew prophets, which are very instructive for understanding a biblical definition of freedom, so often when the people are being confronted by the prophets, you know what the prophets do? They recount to Israel their journey of freedom out of bondage in Egypt into God's promised land. And so often the prophets remind them that you were given freedom and it was costly. And you were given freedom so that you could live in a particular way. And what is that particular way? What is it that the prophets over and over and over again remind the people of? They were set free to live justly before God and before one another. Over and over again, you see the prophets indicting the people for misusing their freedom. Freedom was not to do what they wanted. Freedom was to do what God wanted them to do with their lives. And they see that lived out in what James alludes to at the end of chapter 1. Taking care of those who are marginalized, the orphans, the widows, and to keep oneself, as James says, from being polluted by the world. How do you and I know if our lives are being shaped by God's word, which should humble us, shape us, and set us free? We start to find in our actions, perhaps we have more patience with those people who just really get on our nerves. And I know none of you have them. We find that our words start to be kinder. The edges have a bit of a roundness to them. We find that when we see those in distress around us, the orphans and the widows among us, that our heart goes out to them and we seek to do what we can to help them. We find more and more that the values of this world no longer hold an appeal to us. There's only one person who's ever existed who was completely and totally shaped, humbled, and transformed and set free by God's word, his son Jesus. Over and over and over and over and over and over again, in every interaction, it seems, that Jesus had with another human being, what did he do? He quoted scripture. It became such a part of his life that he almost didn't even have to think about it. It would just come out when he was tempted, when he was asked questions, when he was healing, when he was loving, when he was sitting down to eat with others. Scripture shaped and formed everything he did. And in doing so, he gives us an example that you and I can also be so humbled, shaped, and set free by the word that God has given to us, that it can shape and change everything we do. That's what James desired for his original audience, and that is still God's will for us today. And so, friends, as we journey through this book of the Bible and as we seek to figure out what it looks like to live out our faith on the ground, immerse yourself in Scripture. It will change you. Amen. Friends, as you're able, as we conclude our worship, please rise as we join together in our hymn, Sent Forth by God's Blessing. You'll find it in your hymnal on page 664. Thank you. Brothers and sisters, as you leave this place, go forth in peace. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And all the people of God said, amen. Amen.